Well, greetings. My name is Peter Hay, and I'm standing here in the sanctuary of the United Methodist Congregation that gathers in Wilmington, Massachusetts, and our Director of Christian Education and Youth Ministries, Jameson Rudd, is with us, and one of our lay leaders will be reading the Holy Scriptures for us, and she'll do that. Denise will do that remotely today. But I welcome you to this, the first Sunday of Advent, a time of worship and preparation, both for the precious gift of the Christ child at Christmas and for the unfolding wonder that is God's grace in this very special season. So we're delighted that you're here. And now Jameson and I will lead you in a, we'll share in a dramatic reading that sets the theme for this sermon series and for this season of Advent. Bah, humbug! Merry Christmas. What right have you to be merry? What's Christmas time to you but a time for paying bills without money? A time for finding yourself a year older, but not an hour richer.
He was sitting there, making change, a creditor with a cold heart, making decisions about people's lives.
Will they eat? Will they not? Will they have a roof over their head? Will they not?
Will their children live? Or will they not? Will they go to debtor's prison? Will they not? It is a story born a long time ago and far away.
Or is it?
Still, we live in a world where the chasm between haves and have-nots,
hoarding and generosity, privilege and oppression, continue.
Will they eat or will they not? Will they have a roof over their head? Will they not? Will their children live? Will they not?
He was sitting there making change. And then at the toll of a bell and the blink of a night, his life, it changed forever.
God has thrown the mighty from their thrones. Are we ready for such redemption? What will it mean?
Facing our fears, forgiving ourselves,
compassion for others, working to change tragic trajectories. Christmas is a kind, forgiving, charitable and pleasant time, the only time I know of in the long calendar of the year when people seem by one consent to open their shut-up hearts freely and to think of people below them as if they really were fellow passengers to the grave, and not another race of creatures bound on other journeys. And therefore, Uncle, though it has never put a scrap of gold or silver in my pocket, I believe that it has done me good and will do me good, and I say, God bless it. Our opening hymn this morning is hymn number 211, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel.
Saint and Steve.
Would you join me in our opening prayer, read responsively? Your words will be on the screen. Holy living God, blessed Jesus, guiding spirit, we open today to this journey of past, present, and future, knowing that you hold all of it in your hands. You hold all of us in your hands. Open us to your miracle just begun, and in this season, transform us into those whose giving brings peace in a turbulent world. Open us to you, to each other, and to the voices no one hears, so that your reign of mercy, justice, and love can be made known to all.
To the voices no one hears, we have come to find you with your laughter and your tears, goodness, hope, and virtue. Family, parents, children, friends, each a treasure be. One lantern's light dispels the night. Now our eyes can see, burning brighter than the sun. God bless us, everyone.
And today we share the light of peace. Peace for those terrorized by inner turmoil or outer strife. Violence at home, acts of hatred, a ravaged earth, or a scarred psyche. We share this light because we believe that peace is possible through God's redeeming presence among us. A miracle has just begun. God bless us, everyone.
This week's scripture lesson will have a reading from the Old Testament and the New Testament. From the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. And for our New Testament reading, it's found in the book of Luke, chapter 1, verses 46 through 47 and 52 through 55. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors." Let's hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God.
Well, this brings us to our time in our service for our children and for the child in each of us. And as we come out of the Thanksgiving season and enter into this time of Advent, maybe with our tummies still stuffed, I thought it's a good time to maybe talk and think about birthdays. So for the kiddos out there, I'm guessing you've had your birthday this year. There might be one or two of you that still have a birthday to come in 2021. But I wonder if any of you are already looking forward to your birthday next year. Maybe you've got plans for what theme your party's going to be, or what gift you really hope you get for your birthday, or where you want to go for your birthday, what friends you want to invite, who knows what plans you've made for your next birthday. Birthdays are exciting, right? We look forward to them and we can't wait. We make plans and we maybe change our plans and who knows, and then eventually we get to celebrate. And Christmas is kind of like a birthday, right? We mentioned that last week, actually, that on Christmas we celebrate the birth of Jesus. But I want you to imagine, what if your birthday happened more than once a year? What if it happened twice a year. It would be pretty exciting, right? Twice as many birthdays. What if it happened every week or every day, though? You might get a little bit of birthday burnout, I think. It might just become a little, maybe you'd want a birthday where your celebration is just to stay home for once instead of having to celebrate constantly and maybe not open so many gifts. I think that's kind of how birthdays work, is that they're exciting and they're meaningful because they don't happen every day. They're a special time. We have that time where we really look forward to them and build them up, and that's what makes it so great. Well, right now in our church calendar, we're in the season of Advent. That means it's not really Christmas yet, right? We start to hear Christmas songs. We see Christmas decorations. I bet most of you have your Christmas tree up, but it's not quite Christmas. At least Jesus isn't quite born. Advent is the time where we kind of build, we anticipate, we look forward, we make plans for how excited we are for Jesus' birth. And sure, as Christians, we can be excited about Jesus year-round, right? And chances are Jesus wasn't born in December, on December 25th or anything, but we've set this time to make it that much more important. Just like your birthday. Sure, you're happy to be alive all year round, right? But you look forward to it. You anticipate it. You get excitement built up. And that's kind of what this season of Advent is. As we look forward to Jesus coming, to be reminded of how important it is that God would send God's Son to be born as a little baby in a manger. And the amazing story that is. And if we talk about it every day, we might lose a little bit of that power. But in this season, we're reminded that it's a thing that we anticipate, that we should be excited for and look forward to. So would you pray with me? Dear God, in this season of Advent, we look forward to the coming of the baby Jesus, to his birth in a manger. And we pray that you would, in these coming weeks, help us to be in a spirit of what Christmas truly is, a spirit of anticipation of sending your Son that would change the world for all of us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. And my spirit exalts in God my Savior. For he has looked with mercy on my lowliness, and my name will be forever exalted. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and his mercy will reach from age to age. And holy, holy, holy is God's name. He has mercy in every generation. He has revealed his power and his glory. He has cast down the mighty in their arrogance, and has lifted up the meek and the lowly. He has come to help his servant Israel. He remembers his promise.
Well, during this Advent season, we're on a journey to take a look at how God blesses each and every one of us with the ability to be transformed. The chimes in the clock tower bells in Dickens' classic A Christmas Carol provided a wake-up call for Ebenezer Scrooge and turned him from his resentment, fear, and isolation. And each week, when we hear the bells ring, just as Scrooge did, well, we too might be open to a transformation. You know, the cultural context for in which Dickens places the powerful Christmas Carol is England in the 1800s. That was a time when there was a great big divide between the rich and the poor. And that was something that Charles Dickens wanted to shed some light on. And so his main character is Ebenezer Scrooge. It's clear as the story begins that the only redeeming value in life for this one was getting more money. He lives in resentment and fear, and in an ice-cold, frozen state of watching out only for himself. But God's economy, on the other hand, is just the opposite. In God's economy, there's abundance. There is enough for everyone. And all people deserve to participate in the goodness of life and its joy and its freedom. So this series might help us to challenge ourselves, to make change, to move toward a more just, compassionate time for all people. Will we move toward a richness of peace for all? Or will we continue to be chained by poverty and by exclusion? Well, you know, the story of Ebenezer Scrooge is quite familiar. It happens on a Christmas Eve, and Ebenezer Scrooge hates Christmas, mostly because all the joyfulness is about giving and generosity and caring. And Scrooge is a miser, hoarding all of his wealth. And on Christmas Eve, he's visited by four ghosts, according to Charles Dickens's story. The first is his deceased business partner, Jacob Marley. And he comes bearing a warning for Ebenezer Scrooge that if he does not change his ways, he will be troubled, living the consequences of a selfish life. And then Jacob Marley tells Ebenezer Scrooge that three more ghosts will visit him that night. The ghost of Christmas past, the ghost of Christmas present, and the ghost of Christmases in the future. And these ghostly visitations awaken Scrooge, and he becomes transformed. Now, I don't think I know anybody who's quite as miserable as Ebenezer Scrooge. But I do recognize little threads of resentment and miserliness running through my own life. If Ebenezer Scrooge can be redeemed, then so can I, and so can you. Now, I do not know if Charles Dickens imagined himself to be a Christian or not. But I do think that part of this classic Christmas carol flows beautifully from a strong biblical tradition, particularly a part of our biblical tradition that teaches us to value and to give honor to those who are poor and those who struggle. For those were the words on Mary's lips that we heard this morning from the Magnificat. My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for God has brought the powerful down from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. God has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich empty away. No, the Christmas story is about God creating justice for the poor and God reshaping human society so that all have what they need. You know, I wonder when Charles Dickens imagines the ghost of Jacob Marley, if he didn't have one of the parables that Jesus told in the back of his mind. There's a parable about a rich man who had a beggar living very close to him, and every day they passed each other. Perhaps you know the story. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen, and he feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. And even the dogs would come and lick at Lazarus's sores. The poor man died and was carried by the angels to Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried. In Hades, where he was being tormented, he looked up and called, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in the water to come and to cool my tongue, for I am in agony in these flames." But Abraham said, "Child, remember that during your lifetime you received good things, and Lazarus, in a like manner, evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so. And no one can cross from there to us." Then he said, "Father, I beg you, send Lazarus to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them, so they do not also come to this place of torment." And Abraham replied, "Ah, they have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them." He said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent." And he said to them, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone rises from the dead." Perhaps the ghost of Jacob Marley is based on an understanding of that parable. Scrooge has a conversation with Jacob Marley in that novel. And Scrooge says, "But you were always a good man of business." But the ghost of Jacob Marley responded back, "Business, humankind was my business. The common welfare was my business. Charity, mercy, forbearance, and benevolence were all my business. The dealings of my trade were but a drop of water in the comprehensive ocean of my business. Maybe Advent is a season where we enlarge our souls, that we come to understand other people and the world more completely, that we awaken, stepping from our fears and our isolation. I was sorting through the catalog of my own life, thinking about a story of transformation, and one experience came back to me. I'd like to share it with you. I was in my, I think it was my first or my second year in ministry. It was this very weekend, the first Sunday of Advent and the Sunday right after Thanksgiving. Well, there was a lot to do, and it was a shorter week because of the holiday. And as I was getting ready for the service and the next Sunday, there was suddenly a knock on my door. I opened the door, and there was a man standing in a black suit with a clerical collar on, and he was carrying a beautiful pulpit robe and a suitcase. He introduced himself, saying that he was a bishop in the Free Methodist Church, and he was making his way from Alaska to Baltimore, Maryland, where he would participate in a Pan-Methodist service at Lovely Lane Chapel in Baltimore, Maryland. Well, I had a little difficulty believing his story. I don't think you have to go through Derry, New Hampshire if you're going from Alaska to Baltimore. And then he offered to sell me his pulpit robe if I'd give him $50. So we talked some more. And he told me about some of the difficulties in his life. Now, it's not my custom to give out cash to people who come seeking it, but if there's a way that I can be helpful without actually giving people cash, I do it in that way. Well, he really wanted to get to Baltimore. So after we talked, I took him down to the bus station. I bought him a ticket, and we talked. Then he got on the bus and went on his way. Well, you know, I never thought much about him after that, until that Christmas Eve. I tuned in to the midnight service from Lovely Lane Chapel in Baltimore. Now, and as they panned the crowd for that celebration, well, there he was. There was that man with that same pulpit robe draped over that same suitcase. He had an aisle seat. And so I mused. I thought about him and our connection, that it was a moment of transformation for me, that I was so caught up in trying to get all of my work done on time that he interrupted me I learned the story of his life. And I became, I think, a bigger person as he told me all about his struggles. Well, my friends, may this Advent be for us a time of spiritual awakening, of being less self-absorbed and more engaged, more deeply concerned and connected. May we go from humbug, bah humbug, to the great affirmation, God bless us, everyone. Amen.
O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel, that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear.
Rejoice, Emmanuel,
O Israel. O come, thou day spring, come
and cheer our spirits by thine advent.
Disperse the gloomy clouds above
and dash dark shadows put to flight.
Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
O come, thou King of David, King of David, wide our
heaven,
make safe the way that leads on high, and close the path of misery.
Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, Holy
Well, I do want to continue to express my gratitude to so many of you for your ongoing faithful support. Many go to the website and make their gifts by following the prompts for online giving. Others go to their bank and arrange to have their gifts sent through the bank's bill pay service. And still others write us checks and mail them in and or drop them by and give them to us. But however you choose to give, I want you to know that your gifts matter. They are very, very important, and because of your faithfulness, we as a church are able to continue to be faithful to the things that matter most to us. So we thank you for your generosity. Now, it's not really our custom to share the joys and concerns out loud on this weekend worship video for privacy's sake, but if there is a way that we could pray for you, I hope that you would reach out and let us know. You can send us a message on Facebook. You can call us on the phone. You can drop us an email. However you'd like to reach out and talk to us, we'd be pleased. And if there's a way that we can pray, we would count that a privilege and an honor. So now I'd invite Jameson to come and lead us in our weekend prayers.
Would you pray with me? Gracious God, as we enter this Advent season, we know that too often we have been people of closed hearts, of closed minds. We've been the people of bah humbug rather than God bless us, everyone. And we pray that you would open our hearts, open our minds in this time as we prepare for the coming of your Son, that we would have our eyes open to see in each and every person that we encounter someone born a human, born as your beloved creation, no different than Jesus born in a manger, that we would see in them a shared journey toward you and a shared path on this earth, that we would approach them with empathy, with compassion, with generosity, and with care, that we might truly see in them a neighbor, not someone to be used or bested, but someone to be empathized with. And we thank you for this opportunity to gather here as your people and to receive this message. We thank you that we might come here to prepare our hearts, to prepare our minds for the coming of your Son. And we pray that we would go from this place empowered to be your hands and your feet in the world, that we would proclaim his coming not just with our words, but with our actions, with our deeds, with those things that we give our mind and our time and our energy to. And we pray that you would work in each and every one of our lives, especially those with facing difficulties that, though we have not mentioned them here today, we know that they are known to you. Those in times of anxiety and uncertainty, those in times of illness and recovery, those facing violence and war around the world, we pray that you would place your healing hand in those situations, that you would bring comfort where it's needed, bring peace, bring clarity and wisdom. All this we pray as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, as we come to our time of announcements, we have had now 2 weeks with our youth gatherings in the evenings. We've been small but mighty, and I would continue to encourage you, if this is something that you find to be important, if it's something that you think is something that you have strengths to offer in, I would love to hear from you. We have need of people. We need behind the scenes people that kind of meet and vision and explore options and ideas for the future. We need people that are willing to come and just be a warm body and a caring voice for our youth. Any of these ways that you would like to be involved, whatever skill or talent you have to offer, I'm sure we have a use for it. And I would continue plugging on we are meeting every Sunday from 5 p.m. to 6 p.m., but I'm especially plugging our the Sunday before Christmas. I believe that's the 19th. We have a caroling around town with some of our homebound members scheduled, and I foresee that or imagine that being sort of a family event, whether you are family of youth, whether you are a younger sibling or a parent or just someone in our church family that would like to come and support that ministry. I think it can be very impactful and meaningful for those that are caroling and also those that are receiving the carols. So I'd encourage you to reach out to me if you'd like to join in on that so we can make sure we have the right number of drivers and transportation and all that fun stuff. But we would love to have you no matter who you are. Thank you very much.
I would also share with you this letter that we got from the district superintendent, from our superintendent, Wee Chang. As the district superintendent of the Commonwealth East District, and in consultation with the pastor, I'm authorizing the call of a special charge conference of the Wilmington United Methodist Church on Tuesday, November 30th at 7 p.m., and that meeting will be held via Zoom. The purpose of the conference is to take any legal action with respect to the Boy Scouts of America bankruptcy litigation and that by December 14th of 2021. Now, a charge conference is a meeting where only those members who are duly elected to the administrative board are allowed to vote. However, we will distribute the link widely. If you're curious, if you want to know what's going on, you can tune in and hear what's happening, what's being considered, and it's an important decision. So that will be Tuesday night, 7 o'clock, via Zoom. So those are the announcements that we wanted to share with you. And I invite us now to sing together that great Advent hymn, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, number 196.
Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins, release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever, now thy gracious kingdom bring. By thine own eternal Spirit, rule in all our hearts alone. By thine all-sufficient merit, raise us to thy glorious throne.
Well, there's a little Scrooge in each of us, yearning to thaw, yearning to love again. This week, may we be visited by a surprising peace that surpasses our understanding. And when we feel it, even just for a fleeting moment, may we know that a miracle has just begun in us for the sake of the whole world. And may we be blessed by our God, who loves deeply, by Jesus, the true gift of God to each of us this season and in all of our days, and by the Spirit who shows up just in time. Amen.